I actually also studied with Jack in the early 90s when I was in Israel. So the trend continues. But I'm going to do something different. I actually want to today recognize Mordechai Kaplan for his significance as a thinker about the nature and importance of Jewish memory. This is a slice of Jewish intellectual life that particularly fascinates me. And it's an area in which I think Kaplan has a profound and very, very under-recognized impact. So I'm going to talk a little bit about how that is, why that is, and trace his influence in the next 2 minutes and 30 seconds. That's why I wrote it out. So Judaism as a Civilization was published at a time when thinkers like Maurice Halbwachs and Sigmund Freud were intensely engaged with questions about the nature of communal or collective memory, which is very much a Jewish topic. And I think Kaplan addressed that in clear and unambiguous terms. So in Judaism as a Civilization, Kaplan makes an argument for folk ideology or folk sancta, and he calls these, and I'm quoting him here, the religious beliefs, ethical standards, and national ideals which give coherence and continuity to a civilization. And then he goes on to say, and I'm quoting him again, that these sancta form the elements of self-consciousness in the civilization. They provide the folk with memory of its past and aspirations for the future, and so create the human differentia of group continuity and group history. So I think Kaplan's genius here is really in describing the genius of the Jewish people. That is the way we engage in the ongoing task of recreating, or really reconstructing, the past in the present in order to ensure the future. So this goes on from Kaplan and down many, many different streams, but I want to mention one, which is a book I think perhaps many of you are familiar with, and that is the Yosef Chaim Yerushalmi's rather iconic book, Zachor, Jewish History and Jewish Memory. Because I think in that work, Yerushalmi makes a distinction between Jewish history and Jewish memory, linking memory to traditional structures of Jewish life and history, and then and linking history to the tools and methods of modern historiography. Yerushalmi's understanding of the relationship between Jewish memory and Jewish civilization, I think, is highly Kaplanian. His analysis of the clash between history and memory is very insightful and profound. But Yerushalmi's conclusions read very differently than I think Kaplan's would had he been writing in 1981, which is when Zachor was published. Yerushalmi's just, he's very worried. He's just worried about everything. And I think this is because he is much more concerned about restoring than reconstructing. So if you'll indulge me just for a couple more seconds, I don't want to leave you with Yerushalmi. I want to quickly trace Kaplan's line of thinking one step farther. I want to find Rabbi Kaplan a less angst-ridden intellectual heir. And I think we find that actually in Standing Again at Sinai, where Judith Kaplan draws directly from Yerushalmi's work. What did I say? Did I say Kaplan? Okay. So Judith Plaskow draws directly from Yerushalmi's work there, and she claims that history and historiography can be used in a feminist reshaping of Jewish memory. So she quotes directly from Yerushalmi and says that modern historical writing brings to the fore texts and events and processes that never really became a part of Jewish group memory. So she's not as concerned about paralysis and collapse in the way that Yerushalmi is. I think she stands firmly in line with Kaplan in seeing fresh possibility in constructing and reconstructing Jewish memory, or in her words, and I'm quoting, remembering and inventing together help recover the hidden half of Torah.